Watching him in the basement with our neighbors and our friends, dancing to music, having him do this spin or that dance step, he was so happy and so into that then, and so carefree. He loved it so much. It was his natural ability to excel at an art form.
He liked being the creative director. He liked getting all the kids together and saying, now you're gonna do this, and you're gonna do this, and we're gonna swing around, and I mean, he really enjoyed that. That was fun, yeah. And having plays, he called it adventures. Creating adventures, remember that's what he said, adventures for all the kids.
So testing, talking, now you talk.
Tonight is night one of our trip.
We are Young Gay America, and we drive around North America, and we interview gay and lesbian youth.
We came to Vancouver to pick up our van, which is the ultimate uncool family van, a dusty green Toyota Sienna. It doesn't get any more family van than that.
Okay, we're all set. We go to different regions of the country, and we interview people who've requested to be interviewed via our website. So we were asked to take a camera with us on our fifth trip.
We're gonna have the spirit of Jimmy Wheeler with us, I think, and we're gonna have his poetry.
I hope to find out that gay and lesbian, bisexual, transgender, you name it, the whole gamut, kids out there in the heartland of America are living great, happy lives and doing what they want to do and being resilient, cool people.
I'm looking forward to meeting a whole bunch of younger kids who were possibly in the same kind of situation I was a few years ago, and even having some kind of an impact on them and giving them a sense of acceptance.
We have no idea what to expect. None of the three of us have been to Kansas or Nebraska or Oklahoma or Texas, especially not in August. Probably we're gonna find some amazing stories that are really gonna shock us. I think that there's gonna be towns that have young gay life in them that we had no clue could be possible.
I hope that Jimmy Wheeler's spirit is in the truck with us, is doing the interviews with us, and is seeing that things are getting better out there, and there's no turning back now. I think that's what I hope he sees.
It's a very quiet neighborhood, it's a very quiet area. It's got beautiful hills and beautiful trees, rivers and farmland, just farmlands with big tall silos and cornfields. It's very peaceful out here, very peaceful. It's very conservative. And in Lebanon, in this area, maybe other areas too, if you're different, it isn't taken very well. It's not accepted very well to be different.
Halifax, Nova Scotia.
Where are you guys going?
We're going
on a 2-week road trip.
Make a right screenplay.
Another word.
Make a get it done yesterday.
time I was here was about 2 years ago.
Where?
Olympia, Washington, my hometown.
Okay, last time I was here in Olympia, Washington.
The last time I was here in Olympia, Washington.
Okay, but say it without the big grins.
The last time I was here in Olympia, Washington.
The last time I was here was about 2 years ago. My hometown, Olympia, Washington. That's where we are right now. It's weird to be back here. I always say that, well, this is kind of somber, but because, like, I grew up here, but because both my parents don't live anymore, that I feel like this place is like a part of my past that doesn't exist anymore, so it's very weird to come back to it. Plus, I was never gay here. I couldn't possibly be gay here. My high school was so hick that there was one guy, I remember everyone thought he was gay, but he had to leave the school because he got picked on so much. There's my school, Tumwater High School. There's the stadium where we used to run track. It makes me sick to look at it because it's like the pride of Washington, Tumwater High School, football players. And if you're not a football player, you're nothing. It was my way of revenge at those assholes to decide that I was gonna take over the school. So I ran with my friends for student government, and I was elected the president of the student body, and I was elected the president of the honor society, and the captain of the track team and the cross country team. And I had a column in the school newspaper, and I was the lead in the school musical, and I kicked everybody's ass. And I know they didn't like me, but that's okay, because I left.
I walk the dogs every day back here, and it's a good think time. It's a good time for reflection. Oh, it does what I guess church does for a lot of people. It's a religion. Gives you faith where you lose faith sometimes. I would say Jimmy was like any of my other children, except Jimmy always was more geared towards girl things, dolls, enjoyed playing with other girls more than the typical stereotypical thing where a boy is supposed to play with a boy, that sort of thing. Always very kind, sensitive, was not good in sports, wasn't into the rough, tough push him for soccer or this, that, and the other, you know. He enjoyed more the calmer things.
He thought he was such a great artist. He just painted all the time, and he wrote poetry. And the sad part is I didn't even know about his poetry until the very end. I didn't know that he had a whole book full of poetry he'd been writing all his life. I guess he never felt like he wanted to share that with everybody else.
He was in the church choir, but it was called Energy, but he couldn't sing, absolutely horrible at singing.
But he loved his art. That was what he thought his talent lied. And he would always say, I know I'm good at art.
Green eyes, big full lips, bigger nose. I think he was good looking.
He was tall, skinny. Like every normal teen, he had acne, which he took hard. He loved to experiment with his hair.
Sometimes he had long hair. That was like, he had one time when he had long hair, like down here, like bright Ronald McDonald red. And then he had short hair like this, and it was bright black. And he had earrings, I mean, uncountable, in his tongue. He'd come upstairs 1 minute, and then next time he comes upstairs, he'll have another safety pin up on his eyebrow. He always pierced himself everywhere.
I remember his belly button was all red, and I was like, why, and cold. And I was like, why is your belly button cold and red? And he's like, don't tell Mom, but I tried to pierce it.
He very much wanted to be beautiful in the socially accepted sense of the word. In many ways, he just wasn't. Then maybe, I guess, he thought in his own way that if he were beautiful, he'd be accepted.
Hello.
This is Teddy. Hi, how are you doing?
This is Chris.
Good. Oh, yeah? I ran into your friend, Ari, at the center tonight. For this Young Gay America thing that we were doing. They constantly have the camera on. It's kind of weird to be, like, always filmed and stuff. Yeah. 18th is a good street, yeah. Yeah, it starts to get a little hilly near my house, but then it's flat. He's getting another call. He's so cute. Hi. Oh, no problem. That was quick. We're actually probably gonna go to bed pretty soon because we have to wake up at like 5 or 4 to make it to Salt Lake City by the time we need to interview people at 8 there, 8 p.m. I'm gonna take some photos and God knows we'll have enough videotape of the whole thing. Okay. Take care. Bye bye. He's so cute. I wish I had a picture of him I could show the camera and then they would understand the whole. All the excitement.
Well, you know why I'm not turning the camera off is because the conversation you just had is what Jimmy Wheeler could have had. And I don't know if he ever imagined he could have the conversation on the phone that you just had. So I think it paints a pretty amazing picture of the great things that lie ahead for someone in Jimmy Wheeler's shoes.
They learn how to care for other people and how to share. How to be part of a larger community and how to socialize and share things and not be number one. The hard part was there was no time for individual attention. It was hard to give that. You're always changing a diaper or feeding somebody or driving someplace. It was a lot of work. It was a lot of work.
He fit in well with the family. He was helpful. He was very kind with, especially Elizabeth. He related very well to Elizabeth. And never seemed to have much trouble in school until he hit puberty. And once he hit puberty, things went downhill for him big time. Because I think his big problem there was not fitting in.
You know, they made fun of him all the time at school. And he would pretend like it didn't bother him and, you know, like he would try to laugh it off, but yeah, inside you could just see his heart breaking.
Some gay people are very strong, but Jimmy was not strong. Jimmy was fragile to start with.
I think that they probably felt pretty threatened by someone and something they didn't understand, you know, and someone who was so different, and no one really came out in high school.
A lot of pointing and giggling and like he's something from the sideshow or something. That's almost how it was, like, you know, just ridiculous behavior, I mean.
A lot of name calling. Yeah. People calling him a faggot and queer and a queen, stuff like that. A lot of times it was them just making fun of the way he looked.
I can't imagine anyone so strong, especially at that time in your life when you can just go through it and say, it doesn't matter, that's okay. Sticks and stones will break my bones, but names will never hurt me, like your mother taught you. Well, names do hurt.
You can almost remember him just dealing with all the teasing and getting picked on differently, like as the years went on, and he just kind of got harder and harder and harder, like every year. And so when he used to kind of laugh it off, then he would just start fighting back almost at the end.
Those things that they said to him, he took all that to heart, you know, and he reacted with the sarcasm, but you know deep inside those words hurt him and he could never let go of those words.
Timeline of a Faggot by James Wheeler. I guess I found myself in gym class. I was kind of forced into this role.
I never knew why he hated gym class, you know, but he hated it and he used to like always forget his clothes, you know, so he couldn't participate.
Didn't have a chance to hesitate for a fleeting moment to look back and rinse off the soap scum. I was thrown out of the shower, thrown down to the floor, dethroned with the name Sissy.
He told me one day that he was taken into the shower and called like faggot. Queenie was one of them, you know. They would just call him that. And he told me that the other kids peed on him.
Next came my dumb confession that I couldn't kick the balls, but I could probably find another use for this golden rope not used to climb or rise to higher levels. I could use this to tack up my latest tag, fairy.
He hadn't even come out yet, and he was getting picked on this bad, you know. What if people had known that he was gay? He probably figured if he came out, that'd be the end of it.
Another step in rising above it may be more like overcoming maybes of trying to be butch. But I really condescend as I extend my longest finger and walk the shuttle run.
You could just tell there was a lot of anger just pent up, and sometimes he would just explode and he could really get vicious.
I broke taboos like mirrors and got a flashy fist in my face and returned the favor to my favorite Jock 4, that a closer to politically correct nickname came my way, Homo.
You could just hear the hurt in his voice. You know, when he's trying to act so tough and be so strong, if you know him, you can tell that it's just out of pain.
Then I knew it was time for war. I bought all new armor and a punk rock attitude, sinking fast to an all-time low with every howl and prank I threw their way. It makes me feel so good, my machete in hand, cutting up their egos with an acid tongue, and when they started waging war, I didn't even flinch when they called me faggot.
And it's frustrating because you can tell someone they're wonderful and beautiful, and Jimmy was wonderful and beautiful. And he just, you know, he wouldn't believe the words that you were telling him. And why couldn't he believe the words we were telling him? But he believed all the awful things that he was hearing. Frustrating, you know?
The hardest piece to put together is waking up, realizing you've lost yourself to whispers. Then slowly a crescendo kicks in with Muhammad leading the way to my lost full moon. It shakes and rattles me, but I don't worry about tremors or earthquakes. I just sit back, pop laxative, and howl with newfound lips to a concrete city of angels. Single gay male. That's me.
I couldn't see the value of hurting him. Why does that make them any better as a person to hurt him? He was vulnerable, he was sensitive. Walk by, leave him alone. Don't hurt him. He helped other people. Don't hurt my son.
I think probably maybe what Jim needed was, as he was coming out, get him to be around other gay students and gay teens, to realize that because he saw himself as a freak. And for him to realize that he was a really neat guy, had a lot of potential, and there were a lot of people just like him. But here in Lebanon, he felt like he was the only person.
Michael, what's it called?
Gay LDS Youth.
We're on our way to meet the Gay LDS Youth. LDS stands for Latter-day Saints. This is a Mormon gay group.
The four of us were walking across the street, and we thought, you know, God, I wonder if we're going to get ambushed, or I wonder if this, what's going to happen, because it was kind of weird, and it was kind of like a new town, and, you know, kind of not quite downtown, and we were like, whoa, is this going to be shady or what? You never know what to expect.
Everyone say hi.
Hi.
Okay, we're
I'm gonna do that again, but this time do it.
Oh my God, hello!
I was like, first thought was like, wait, are these guys really all gay? And then, you know, the second thought was, God, we have a lot of work to do in the next hour and a half.
In Salt Lake, there's such a great divide, it seems like. There's, you know, those that are LDS, Molly Mormons, if you will. They don't smoke or drink or do drugs. And then there's the other extreme, the club scene. But in there, there's a lot of drugs and a lot of drinking. And I mean, that's okay. But at the same time, it's like, it's not really where you want to go right after you've left a Mormon background.
My dad's reaction was kind of like, he said, you're gay. So you're a fag. You're queer. You like men. And my answer was just yes to all of his questions, you know. The decision was, you know, you go talk to the bishop or you leave. So I went and I talked to my bishop, and I don't think he knew what to do about it either, really. You know, he seemed confused. And he said, this is the first time I've ever had to deal with anything like this.
When I was in high school, here and in Oklahoma, I was severely depressed, mostly because I was gay. Didn't think I belonged to anything for anybody. Then when I came out the end of my freshman year of college, it was fantastic. And I, this is me, I'm happy all the time.
It's really hard here to find people who have similar values, who have similar interests, who aren't all about drug use and drinking and being bitter and drama, that are all about just, you know, having good morals and not being sad because you're gay or blaming someone because you're gay, but just being excited and rejoicing because you're gay.
Getting out here and realizing how huge the gay community was in Salt Lake City was a shock to me. I couldn't believe it, and I couldn't be happier. Where I was before, I was very alone and felt like I was the only person out there that was the way that I was, and I thought there might have been something wrong with me. But it's helped me to come to understand better who I am and to accept myself and to love myself better and to be a happy person, because being depressed is not a fun thing.
Are you happy to be gay, Jeremy?
This morning was a really amazing experience to just sit outside the Gay and Lesbian Community Center in Utah. The community center is such a fabulous place.
They really don't know what's going on in Utah. I see that with my family, who are very strong LDS. They don't know what's going on. They don't have a view of the outer world. And I think that's the greatest thing, being a part of this minority, is we have an education of everything that's around us.
And I've always been like an outsider. At first I always hated it, because I just wanted to be a part of the big crowd, because I was always at the back of the dances and I was always in the back of the classroom. But it gave me like a different perspective looking in. Like, I saw their interactions and stuff. And if I were like inside that group of people, I probably wouldn't see it the same way.
I am a part of their world. Like, they don't have to acknowledge that, and they don't have to accept that, and they don't have to like it. I'm not here to change anyone's opinion. But look at me, I am a positive person in this society, and I do amazing things.
I didn't even flinch when they called me faggot. The hardest piece to put together is waking up, realizing you've lost yourself to whispers.
I think it was really amazing when we pulled Jim Wheeler's poetry out and asked the kids we were interviewing to read the poetry. It was amazing to see the reaction and the emotion that comes through in James Wheeler's poetry.
Single gay male, that's me.
That's the stuff. We got in the van after that, and we were just like, wow, that is so cool. Now it makes sense. What we're doing makes sense. All this traveling and everything, all the driving, all that annoying stuff we're doing right now made sense.
He was great at making your day. He could just be so silly and see that you're bumming about something and just make you crack up, you know, and it just made you want to do the same thing for him.
Yeah, he would do anything to make sure that you were happy, you know? When we were in high school, Jimmy was kind of like the class clown. He was the clown of our group, and he always made everyone laugh.
Here in this classroom, he had a very close-knit group of friends, and I would see them laughing together, talking about their artwork, or just being silly a lot of the times.
He could just let it flow there, and he didn't have to be worried about anyone in the class picking on him, because we were all friends. We were all friends.
Oh, he was a wildly imaginative young man. A lot of students, because they don't really trust their originality, you know, so they rely on tried and true symbols. Jim was going beyond that very quickly, to the point where whenever you would see something new that he was working on, it would be startling.
Sometimes when I would see Jim's work and I would, you know, be aware of symbolism and think about it, you know, you sort of try to make conversations where he would feel that he could talk about it if he wanted to. But I oftentimes had the sense that Jim didn't always want to go there, that he just wanted this to be a calm, safe, and normal place for him to be.
I was worried about him getting through high school without too many bumps and bruises, you know, emotionally. But I really thought Jim was going to find a home outside of high school, a place where he was with other young people of similar interests that were into the visual arts and that wrote poetry and that had conversations in coffee houses. And that's where Jim belonged.
Jim's work had a lot of color in it, and I remember some of our conversations being about color and how color affects a mood and, you know, what color was working in his paintings and what wasn't working. And when we walked into his funeral and his artwork was present, it was one of the more overwhelming things that I've dealt with as a teacher. The artwork was there representing him, and it was just overwhelming. You know, I remember walking from painting to painting and touching the paintings. You know, it was tangible. There just are not words that can explain this situation.
Yeah, I would.
There aren't words that can explain the feelings or the thoughts. Maybe Jim would have had the words.
Usually by the end of the day after school, you know, either he'd be venting or he'd be like in a really good mood and we'd just be like having a lot of fun, and he was like so psyched about singing.
Everybody's free.
Everybody's free.
He would sing all the time on the way home, and there was like this song, it makes me laugh so bad when I think about it, but there was a Romeo and Juliet. When the movie came out again, there was a song from the soundtrack that he just loved, and it was like this little boy singing this choir song, and it's like this super high voice, and he used to sing that song all the time, and it was just the most piercing thing in the world, and I would just crack up.
About 60 miles outside of Pueblo. We're going down from the Rockies.
Hey, what's going on?
Hey, how you doing?
I always wanted a mohawk, and one thing I learned about my dad is you never just ask. If you want to do something crazy, you just do it, and he'll grow to accept it. And so I went and did my mohawk, and for Pride, it was bright pink. The one thing we did this year, me and Anna, we started Pueblo's first gay Pride. It was kind of our little brainchild.
Yeah, we were sitting at our local IHOP talking about it, because we just came back from the Denver's gay Pride. And we thought, She brought up that, you know, Pueblo should have one. This would be really neat if it had one, and I agreed, and we just started making notes and making contacts that night.
Did you go to a school for typing? There had never been any gay pride events before, any as big as ours. There were picnics in the park with P flag or whatever, but there had never been anything like, you know, 200 people. And then we had four protesters at Pride. And, you know, we combated that pretty well. Me and Anna went over and introduced ourselves to the protesters and said there's no such thing as bad publicity, so thanks for coming. And my biggest thing is someday I want to be on CNN with my name and activist scrolling underneath it. And this is just a small place. Like, if I was in Denver or New York or Chicago or any big city, I couldn't make the the impact, because the population's so big and there's 50 other people just like me.
Yeah.
So, I mean, having a small town is definitely inspiring, because everybody knows who you are, and if they like you or they don't, then oh well, but you're making an impact regardless.
We're in the middle of nowhere.
So, where are we right now?
20 miles south of Scotts Bluff, Nebraska.
And we're supposed to be there at 3, and it's...
3.
Right now.
Okay, guys, here we are. Oh, there's the population.
14,732.
Wow, this is rural. This is Scotts Bluff Library. It's gotta be up here. There it is, library.
Here at the Scotts Bluff Public Library in Scotts Bluff, Nebraska. I usually meet gay and lesbian people around here by just going on some internet sites like gay.com and planetout.com, talking to people outside my area, you know. It made me feel better about myself. I finally had an answer to why I felt like this, and there were other people out there like me. My mother, you know, she accepted it very well, but my dad is a very staunch Christian, and he didn't accept it, you know. So I was kicked out of the house 2 years ago, and I don't usually go back there. At first, it was kind of devastating, but, you know, I believe one of these days that Dad will kind of open up and realize that, you know, I'm not going to change and kind of accept me for who I am. Around here, there are very few openly gay and lesbian people here, and a lot of them are in the closet because, you know, a lot of people here are very narrow-minded. If they were to come out and see somebody kissing a male, you know, a bunch of the cowboys here would probably beat the snot out of you. Well, I hope one of these days to find somebody and be in a long-term relationship. Hopefully in Scotts Bluff, but, you know, if I have to move someplace, you know, I'll do that too.
We used to work for a magazine called XY Magazine in San Francisco. We weren't really reaching out to people in rural parts of America. We weren't really getting the experience from sitting in San Francisco what it was like to be young and queer, especially in this time. That's when we had an idea to have a big sort of freight truck, like a big tractor trailer truck, and kind of drive from town to town, almost like the gay carnival, and have a little disco in the back and resources, and sort of go from town to town every 3 days or something. But since we didn't really have the money for that, we sort of sat back and said, let's just make a website and drive around and visit people.
So come on out to the Nebraska State Fair in Lincoln on Monday, August 26th, for the Colgate Country Showdown Nebraska-Iowa State Finals, sponsored by IV, where there's a smile in every aisle.
These are some nice buildings.
I think that I was probably 12 or 13 when I first heard the word gay. Growing up in the church and realizing that you're gay is very difficult. There are churches everywhere. In my hometown, which is a town of 1,000 people, there are 4 Lutheran churches, a Catholic church, at least 2 or 3 other various denominations. You know, your family has never talked about it. I mean, I'm 13 and it's the first time I've heard the word. It's never spoken of in church or at school or anywhere. And when I heard the word and knew what it was, then it was like, hey, I know that. I understand that. That That's me. The love that dare not speak its name was ready to talk, and so... I want to be able to go back to my high school and tell people, you know, I don't know who of you out there is gay, but, you know, there's 400 kids in this school, so there's a good chance that anywhere from, you know, 20 to 60 of you are homosexual. And there's a whole world out there that you don't know because you happen to be born to a family who lives in a small town in the Midwest. I love the Midwest because I can leave my doors unlocked, and I do know the names of my neighbors, and I can go down the street and borrow a weed whacker when I need to clean up the yard. But there are still those things when you're raised in a small town and nobody talks about homosexuality. This is one area where I wish the Midwest could be a little more like bigger cities or the coasts.
Jim in Bold by James Wheeler. In the age of the computer where the internet connects us all and we all struggle in the World Wide Web to become unstuck from the futuristic fact that if your modem isn't on, then you better not expect a fax from your faceless friend who lives halfway across the industrialized continent and doesn't even closely resemble the description that they gave. I resembled my face, and I found an outline face amid all the stereotypes, sexual slurs, catcalls, and whispered secrets. I am Jim. I am boy, I am tall, I am fair-haired, I am a poet, a painter, and if I dare to call myself an artist, I will. I am sensitive, I am angry, I am in love, I am in hiding, I am out of the dark celluloid closet. Yes, I am a homosexual. I am gay, I am queer, a sissy, fairy, fag, a punk, a queenie. I am a girl at heart. A freak, a follower, a leader, a perfectionist, a slob, an optimist and a pessimist. A Quaker and a Nazi. I don't try hard in school, but I'm good in English and I fall asleep in math class. I want to run real fast, but no one will take a chance and pick me for their team. I want to sing real loud in a rock and roll band, but I can't get the words out. I want to be noticed, however I want to be isolated, because isolation brings genius. Make me famous, because I sure want to be, and it's also cool to be anonymous and top secret. I want to be popular, I want lots of friends, but I know I'd get really annoyed with the phone ringing all the time and the non-stop would really kill my nerves. I'm way too sensitive and I cry when I watch The Simpsons. I'm awfully mean a lot of the time because people really piss me off. And I love my family, like they were my best friends, but my house is so stressful with 7 kids and 2 dogs, way over the national average. I want to leave home, but I'm scared to be alone. I want to tell a certain person that I don't want to be alone and that I love him, but the long-forgotten art of speech just won't work. I want a job that pays the bills. I want lots of money, but I'd rather paint the world with vibrant colors and hues. I want to travel and see things that I only see when I'm tossing and turning in my bed, trying to fall asleep, knowing my alarm is going to ring any second, and I better wake up soon if I'm going to learn to drive, to run, to sing, to think, to paint, to grow, to be. But my car of ambition is without a key. So I just sit and wait in my quiet room, in my noisy house, in my sleepy town, in the Keystone State, in the superpower country, in the polluted world, etc., etc., etc. Thinking, contemplating, wishing, dreaming, screaming, hissing, living, loving, hugging, kissing, yelling, crying, dying, listening, hearing, touching, smelling, tasting, seeing, believing. Missing myself until I receive a divine message, maybe from somewhere way up above. And if I believe in the Christian God, then I'd say that God spoke to me, telling me it's better to be hated for what you are than loved for what you're not. Thank you, Muhammad, for publishing my profile, for printing me, printing Jim. Jim in bold, me in bold, I'm in bold.
That's the hardest one to read because it's just so much like him. Kind of just, I think, sums up who he was and what he wanted to be. And, you know, he wanted to be in a rock and roll band and sing. And I just think he wanted to be accepted and well-liked. and normal, whatever that is.
His dream was to be in Philadelphia and be an artist. That was his dream. That was his dream.
He had finally graduated from high school, and I think that he thought a lot of his problems were going to change once he left Lebanon, that everything was going to be different. And he had gotten a scholarship to the University of the Arts. You know, it's a culture shock to go from Lebanon to Philadelphia.
I think Jimmy moving to Philly was, at the time, a really fantastic idea. He needed to be in a place where he could express his ideas and express himself without being made fun of.
But by the time he got there, it's almost like he was already too damaged to be able to appreciate it.
He called home, like I think two times or three times, saying he just hated it. He wanted to come home. He was going to kill himself if we didn't take him out. He didn't like it. He didn't like he could see that there were other gay people there, and he didn't like it.
I remember waiting in line with him when we were at college doing some sort of registration, and he was just looking around, and it was almost like he was just disgusted.
So my mom withdrew him and thought that it was best if he came home and started therapy.
He would come in, I'd say, well, you know, how'd your therapy go? And he'd say, it was okay. Well, what'd you talk about? Not much. Did you talk about any of your problems? I talked about, you know, home and town, and did you talk about being gay? No, we didn't talk about that.
For a while, he went through a really bad depression. He felt like he was just a big loser back in Lebanon, and what was he going to do now? And so he kept working in the city, in Philly. He would work occasionally at Fluffy's.
When he started working for Fluffy, it was really good for him, really good. And it got him back into Philly, and it was just, I think, really therapeutic for him to work for her.
He was very, very sweet, is a term that I think of when I think of Jim. He was very tender and very gentle and very happy when he was working here. It was a whole big deal for him just to be in a studio and be in Philadelphia and be near South Street and be around kids who looked like him. The whole world was his. Except he could never see that the whole world was his. I saw that it was. I mean, I see that kind of potential in any young artist starting out that's as curious and as talented as he is, or he was. I have this little thing that he made. I didn't know about this, but his sister's boyfriend was working for a drug company at the time, and he used to get these little vials from him, and then he would take a hanger, and he would bend them to look like what he had seen me do during the day. One day he came in and he asked me if I wanted to see his new tattoo. And I said, well, you know, it depends where it is, Jim. And he said, no, it's just on my back. It's right here. And I said, sure. And, you know, he took his shirt down and he showed me this tattoo that was a Chinese symbol. And I said, what does that mean? No, it's really pretty. What's it mean? And he said, it means hope.
Did we just go into Kansas?
Yeah.
So Kansas City's not in Kansas?
No, there's a Kansas City, Kansas, and a Kansas City, Missouri.
Missouri's the big one.
Missouri's the big one. But I got it.
I live in two Kansas cities.
There he is. Say hello to the camera.
Hi.
Be excited.
Hey. How's it going?
Stop. Say hello, America.
Hello, America.
There's Andy.
In a je ne sais quoi de Hollywood.
You know how important it is to see a gay boy and his mother on screen?
How important is it?
Very.
Oh, my.
I don't know where they go. There used to be this place called The Planet, but it closed down. It was basically like where all the youth went, that gay youth. That didn't have any place to go. This is like a coffee shop. Yeah. Oh, okay. Now there's really no place for young people. You have to be either 18 or 21 to get into clubs.
We basically just hang out with each other, like each other's houses and stuff.
All the time.
We don't go.
Have fun though.
Yeah, we do have a lot of fun.
Do you feel lucky?
Yeah, very. My family is very loving and supporting of me through everything. Most of my decisions, and then I have a great group of friends I love dearly.
I wish, like, overall, gay youth, gay people in general would be more open about it, not be scared. Because, I mean, nowadays, there's so much more freedom, more acceptance of it, and there's always going to be people, regardless of what you are, who you are, what you do, that are going to bring you down, but if you're strong enough, you have friends, I mean, come on.
The media tends to focus on the stereotypical homosexual.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true.
And I wish that they would focus, you know, more on the day-to-day, just the average Joe walking down the street trying to live life, you know? Just trying to go through high school, go through school, you know, reach their career objectives.
Just like normal, regular people.
Because we are normal, regular people.
I know.
I plan on hopefully flying for a major airline one day.
I want to be an architect. I want to go to K-State and go with Andy. We're going to run together. I wasn't going to do it.
And three.
Can you tighten up and get together?
I Saw Horses Last Night by James Wheeler. I saw horses last night. I was so close to being a cowboy. I could feel the straddle of my legs wrapped around leather saddles. I felt breezes swooshing and swimming past me as I imagined the ride. I saw horses last night, coming in all directions just like Patti Smith said they would. They surrounded me, my Prozac protectors, dulling the knives in my nine lives so I could concentrate on just one. I see horses every night, running to the city, spiraling toward me, toward whatever. I see horses, black, yellow, white, gray, purple, orange, pink, blue, green, red. Maybe I can lasso one and ride away.
It's very, very painful for me to see his poems, and I have not been through his writings. I saw his paintings. He had wonderful paintings. The paintings full of color and full of pain. Full of despair, full of anger.
That's where he got all of that bottled up emotion out.
He had pictures of himself, of a figure being cut, and a figure being hung. And he followed that sequence. It was right there in black and white, and we didn't see it.
When he came home to the University of Arts, he really went downhill fast. He slashed his wrists. He went into Philhaven, which was a big mistake because that's a Mennonite hospital. And of course, you know their feelings on homosexuality. Then we had him in a therapist in town here. And I look back on this now and when I went there one time, I was reading books, you know how you wait for your, and I just happened to pick up a Bible. And one of the things in the Bible, it talked about homosexuals being able to be changed through the power of prayer. So I thought, oh my gosh, what are we doing here? What are we doing here?
I feel like we totally failed him. You know, I feel like all those times he came over to me crying for help, and I just, you know, I got so, it was almost like the boy who cried wolf. That's what I correlate it to, because I feel like he came over all the time telling me, I'm just so depressed. I just can't take it anymore. I just want to kill myself. And I just got so tired of hearing it because I felt like he was this big drama queen. Oh, here goes Jimmy. He's overreacting again. You know, So in that respect, I didn't realize that every cry, or every time he said that, it was a cry for help.
It was like a Greek tragedy. It was like the outcome was known all along, and there was just seemed to be no way to stop it.
Driving on Bandera Road, otherwise known as Texas Highway 16, north of San Antonio. It's quite beautiful countryside. Bandera is a small town 40 miles northwest of San Antonio, where Emily lives down a little road in a mobile home. We have our phones turned on?
Yep.
You never know. Cacti.
Does he say blue truck?
Yep, blue truck, red car,
yes.
Purple car, and Ford Explorer.
Are you Emily? Awesome! We found it!
Hi, I'm Mike.
Hi.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. We have a deck out back if you'd like to go there.
Is it in the sun?
Well, we've got an umbrella. Oh, cool.
His mother did that.
Really?
I've had these shorts for like 7 years.
Ooh. We're in my house in Pipe Creek, Texas. 78003. I'm a senior at Bandera High School. I'm kind of strange at school. I'm not really one of the in crowd, but then again, I don't really want to be. People around here are so crummy towards me and my friends, and you know, like, they're really homophobic. It's so uncool. I just went celibate for a long time. I was like, I'm not gonna deal with this. I'm not gonna deal with anybody, forget it. I'm just gonna be all by myself. That's fine. So I was like that for about 8 months, and I was like, And
that's when you started to feel just not good and sick and
stuff. It was horrible.
Yeah.
I need some sort of contact with other people. You know, I can't live my life all by myself and be depressed all the time. I need to talk to somebody. I need to be with somebody. So just that thought pushed me out of it, and I was like, wow, it's amazing. My family is very good for me. They're, for a long time while I was sick, they'd visit me and they'd comfort me and they'd just make me feel really good about myself. My friends, well, they're a little bit more difficult. A lot of them drop me like a hot rock.
Really?
Yeah. They thought, she is weird. I'm not gonna be near her. Forget her. And I was like, aha!
Yeah.
And so I had to move on through that by finding new friends. I'm totally gonna make new friends, sure. And so I did. I'll be a writer. I like to write stories, and poems, definitely poems. I'm into poems. You guys, I love y'all. You're cool. I'm so glad that I met you, and I wish you all the best, and I hope that your trip back is safe and fun. Love, Emily.
That was quite possibly like the hottest hour of my life, but it was definitely worth it. It was a very cool stop.
Highway of the Bayou of Louisiana.
It might be a nectarine, actually.
I can say supercalifragilisticexpialidocious backwards. Sui caudale vexillifragilis. And I can also say anti-disestablishmentarianism backwards.
Okay.
Missy Narat Nemsel Bats, I say didn't know.
If we were Snap, Crackle, and Pop, who would we do? Snap, Crackle. You're stuck being Pop.
If we were...
Yeah, the lives would be so hard.
Julia
yeah.
Roberts, Susan Sarandon, and...
I mean, I like Susan
what's
Sarandon.
What's another $20 million actress? Goldie Hawn. Who would be who?
I don't want to
Mike's Goldie Hawn.
No way.
Mike's Goldie Hawn.
Why? Just because I have blonde hair? I'm ditzy?
I'm Julia.
No, I am Julia.
I'm Julia.
Now turn the camera off before I break your kneecaps.
Who's gonna drive your ass home?
Okay, we are in the Brenton Bed and Breakfast in Washington, D.C., near DuPont Circle. And we are just getting ready to go up to Wilmington, Delaware, where we're going to do some interviews. We've had a couple days off from filming while we made our way east from Texas. Looking forward to having my own toilet and my own bathtub, and looking forward to having some clean clothes, because these underwear right here, I've been wearing for the last 6 days.
Well, I'm so gayed out from this whole thing. I'm beyond, like, I've had enough gayness for a while. I think I'm gonna go home and kind of enjoy the fact that there's not, like, a gay ghetto or a gay central, and just I can go home and be myself. I don't know, what do I have to complain about? I have nothing to complain about. Some of the kids I've talked about have been kicked out of their houses, okay, and have been mistreated by their families, and have had the, like, saddest stories ever, and I'm here bitching about the fact that I'm on TV. That's pretty sad. And that's what I like to tell a lot of the kids that are also, that we've also talked to, that although sometimes it feels like the world's revolving around you, it's not. Not everyone's gonna care. You think the world's gonna stop if you come out of the closet, but it's not. It's gonna get better, a lot better. And I'd say my life's damn good right about now, so just be brave.
Is it rolling?
Hey, does my hair look okay?
Just kidding. I'm really looking forward to the interviews that we have coming up today and tomorrow. Today's interview is, one is a guy who, his name is JP Justin. He says that he's a great example of someone who was like Jim Wheeler and is not now. Has thrived and survived. The whole point of Young Gay America and the whole point of our project is that gay youth are denied a voice, and it is our goal to get out there and try our best and our resources to put a camera or a computer or, you know, a microphone on these kids who, for whom no one else is doing that.
Yeah, I'm a writer. Mostly I'm a slam poet. Yes, GAF does stand for gay and proud, so fall into the gap or I will push you. I'm attracted to people with convictions. I've dated a Jehovah's Witness and a Seventh-day Adventist. I don't know how the hell that happened. I swear I didn't know when it started. The majority of any real interaction in the gay community that's not clubs is online, which is unfortunate. There's no community center here for gay kids. And I think that's because the community doesn't think we exist. And this was probably more overwhelming when I tried to kill myself. But I felt so invisible to everyone around me who was straight, that it's like being in the middle of the ocean and you don't know which way land is, and it's starting to storm and you have to start swimming somewhere, and you could start swimming, you could be swimming further into the ocean. And, but you're so afraid of doing that that you just kind of stay where you are. That's what it feels like. It feels like just drowning. It's not all bad. I mean, there are times when I'm walking to my car, going to Wawa to get soda, and I look down and I realize that I'm just as much a creation of God as everyone else, and you just feel so connected to everyone.
He loved the shore, and we had a lot of fun at Cape May.
It was like his escape. I mean, he just loved Cape May. He was like a totally different person down there. He was always happy. Always wanted to go to the outdoor mall and shop with the kids. And I mean, he just loved it.
He even loved going birding with me, which, you know, for kids, that's like pulling teeth. I don't want to go birding with my mother. But he was very, very happy down there. That was like his very happiest time, I think, that he's ever been through.
It was the summer of 1997, and I had just gone down to the shore to meet the rest of my family from Delaware. And he and I had such a great time down there together. It was like none of the problems between us had ever existed, because he had his scholarship, I had my scholarship. We were talking about that and how much we looked forward to really getting down to what we were doing and how great everything looked up ahead. And it was great. I mean, I've never, there was none of the old rivalry that we had before. And, you know, I remember that was the one consolation I took when he died, was that was my last memory of him.
I have so many good memories of him because when we would live together in Ocean City, Maryland, we would stay up late sometimes talking and laughing, and it was like we had this synergistic relationship. You know, we kind of fed off of each other. He would tell a joke and I would laugh and it would make him even more funny and vice versa. And we would just stay up laughing and talking and being goofy, and we'd go to the food store together and give each other high fives every time we got a coupon on something because we had no money. And I have a lot of good memories.
We really like bonded when we were little because he liked to play with the same stuff that I did. We had a lot of fun. There were good times.
He was just really funny, outgoing person. Just really, I really like hanging around with him. He'd probably be my best friend if he was still around now. He's a really cool person.
When I was younger, I didn't really feel great about gay people. I was raised in a family that was very, very, you know, structured and rigid, black or white, nothing was gray. But having Jimmy made me more open to people that were gay and accepting the people that were gay. And now, really, and having him as a child was wonderful for me to be more open-minded about gay people. It helped me a great deal. It was very, very painful, but very, very helpful. Thank you, Jimmy.
Hi, Renee, it's Mike with Young Gay America. Good, we got stuck in some traffic, so we're like 3 miles, we just passed the sign and said 4 miles from Wilmington, so. You guys all still there, or? Okay. You gonna? Okay, sorry about that. Okay.
I came out when I was 13, I'm 15 right now, and my dad did not like it at all. Like, I came out like a couple months after my sister did, but my mom, she wants to understand, she pushes herself to understand, but she doesn't. She accepts it. She doesn't like it, but she accepts it, so it's cool. So I just had to come out again during school because everybody knew I was gay because I was a cheerleader.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so.
Tell about that, being a cheerleader. Are you the only guy cheerleader?
I'm the first male cheerleader.
My mom, she's trying. She's like really in the closet about it. She won't mention it to anybody or anything like that. Like, she tries to still act like I'm straight and expects me to act like I'm straight along with her when I'm not like that. It's like, I'm not good at being straight. That's why everybody thought I was gay before I came out.
If you tell, like, if your son comes out and they're Asian, or help you if you're Filipino, it's just, they disown you. They don't want nothing to do with you. You just disgrace the family, unless you go back to where you were, which was straight, back in the closet, whatever.
The thing about being gay is being different, very different. I don't know, it's cool being different, being the oddball. I find being the ball, I'm the oddball, okay, fine.
A good thing about being out is that you can be a good role model for other gay people that are in the closet, and being a good person rather than what they see on TV and what they hear from their peers or their parents or whatever.
I think Will and Grace is a good portray because it shows different types of gay people. It shows the real feminine Jacket, and it shows the quote-unquote normal. What's his name? Will.
Well,
I don't know.
And then, well, I don't see really, like, good black gay characters, I guess you could say. They always see them as big ratty queens.
Yes.
Fight people. Always doing like this.
My friend Lala gave me some advice that I took it very serious. Like, she gave everybody good advice, and she told us that to be yourself, but when you see another homosexual or lesbian or something like that acting the way they are, Don't snap your fingers because they're snapping their fingers. Don't vote because they're voting. Do you, you know? Like, just be yourself.
Just left Philadelphia this morning. Here we are in South Jersey. We are headed to Cherokee High School in Marlton, New Jersey, which is the home of the Cherokee High School Gay Straight Alliance, which is the group that we were about to meet.
Smiling like this. Oh. Rich, you look so low.
Thanks.
Me too.
We haven't actually interviewed a GSA, so someone should explain what it is.
GSA stands for the Gay Straight Alliance. It promotes tolerance and respect and unity of gays and straights alike, and it's trying to show that even though we're different, we're all the same.
People seem to think that they come in, you see the guys over there like decorating and the girls over there playing with power tools, and it's not like that. We're a bunch of just cool people. We'll just chill with you.
When I first came here, I was actually still in the closet, and the way I was before I came out and the way I was treated after I came out, it was the same in the GSA, and it was good knowing that I could come out and still be treated like the same person. It was really cool like that.
There are two teachers that helped our GSA out like here and there when they really could. They themselves were gay, but they're older than us, so they gave us sort of like role models to look up to.
Just the fact that the club exists and that they see a sign in the hallway, they know that they're not alone, even if they don't decide to join us, like even if they don't become friends with us and show their support, they're really not alone.
It's a pretty big high school, and it's easy to get lost and feel like you're alone, and we try to make everyone feel a lot better and like they have some place to go.
I was a little lost puppy before I found the GSA.
One of the first like underclassmen to come out, it was like a huge step for me. I thought to myself, well, there's no turning back. I mean, this is definitely gonna be interesting. As well as like by the way kind of things that you kind of like wanna, don't wanna say I'm gay, but like, yeah, so my boyfriend's doing pretty good. Your what? Your boy, huh? I thought that was easy at first because it didn't seem so bad. But like the next couple of weeks, again, on freshman year, it really showed me the different kinds of things that I was going to be going through throughout high school. My main goal throughout high school, ever since getting involved with the GSA, has been to make as much of a positive impact as possible. Because when I leave Cherokee, like, I don't want to be known as some like famous person, like, oh, Sean, blah, blah, blah. Like,
Sean,
I just...
the gay guy.
Yeah. Like, I just want to leave an impact that will make people's lives easier and make it okay for people that are coming into Cherokee.
What I think people need to realize is that homophobia is contagious, not homosexuality. You can't catch being gay, but if you're in an environment where everyone's homophobic, eventually you're going to become homophobic yourself.
Well, good morning. We're leaving the city of Philadelphia. And we're heading toward Lebanon, Pennsylvania. What we're gonna do is just chat, and we're just gonna have a little interview, a very casual. What we do in all of our cities where we stop is we just sit down and I type on the computer while we talk, and Scott films, and we'll just kind of have a casual conversation about whatever you want to talk about. The point is to get your stories out to peers and to other youth who don't have access to information, don't have access to groups like you might, don't have gay friends, don't have anything like that.
Where do you see yourselves in 20 years?
Why don't you start, Mike?
When I start?
Yeah.
All right. We don't normally get the questions. In 20 years, I will have a family. And it will be not too big, but not too small. And it will be very great and happy.
I think in 20 years, I would definitely like... Well, for me, the sky's the limit. I would definitely like to have a lover. You can see in movies, you'll always see, like, how they finally settle down, they find the true person. And I still think that person's out there.
Yeah, I picture myself in, like, a big house, you know, and all of that stuff. I guess it's the typical dream.
I'd like to be able to have the power to influence change as much as I can in my life. I hope to have a family, and hopefully I'll have my third or fourth dog if I can get one in the next 6 months. If you could look at yourself, say, 5 years ago, maybe you're in high school, maybe you're in middle school, and thinking about the things that you know now, what would you tell yourself?
I probably would tell myself to come out then, because at least then I would have had a chance to have some friendships in high school, as opposed to just being this like solitary individual, an island unto myself. And my relationship with my parents would have been a lot better, because there are these huge like foundational cracks that we're still working on fixing up because of that.
I think if I were gonna give myself advice, I would tell myself not to be afraid, just to let it go, let it happen. Because at some point, I don't know when it was, but at some point I realized that most people really are good people. And even if they behave in bad ways, it's usually not because they're feeling that way, it's because they don't know better.
Susan, you wanna answer?
What would I do differently 5 years ago?
If you saw yourself 5 years ago.
Well, I would do a lot differently. First of all, my son would be here. He would be here, but he would not be here. He would not be in Lebanon. He would be in Philadelphia. We would be seeing a gay therapist down there. He would be exposed to people such as yourself, so that he realized that he was part of an entire group of neat people that had a bright future ahead of themselves. So if I could take myself back 5 years, boy, would I do things differently. Unfortunately, I can't. And I'm stuck with a lot of pain. And this is how I'm dealing with my pain. And my family is dealing with our pain. And pardon me if I get a little emotional. We hope, through people like you, and by being here and helping parents, that, excuse me, there won't be more like my son. So I would definitely do things differently. And I wish I had the chance, but I hope that there are mothers like over there who will realize what a gift they have with their child and will treasure that child and will do everything they can to help that child grow up and realize the full potential to be a great human being.
One, two, three. She's got the right idea. And you're a lucky boy. Yeah. That's such a great mom.
Word got out in school and she questioned me and I was like, yeah, I'm gay. And that's just how it happened. And then from there, I mean, it was like this emotional roller coaster. She was like, oh, and got all teary-eyed and broke out with the like, no matter what, I'm always gonna love you. And it was wonderful. I just felt so like open then.
Gave you a hug.
Yeah.
Left you know that you weren't being like put out there.
Yeah.
Well, my theory in life is a mind works like a parachute. It works best when open. David's David to me, no matter what sexuality he is. He's still a person. He still has his wants, his goals, his needs, you know? And maybe he is the normal one. Maybe I'm the different one. I don't know, you know? What's normal?
Do you wish there were people your age who are out?
Yeah, I mean, you always wish there's, like, more people, because at my school, I'm the largest minority. Like,
you're it.
Yeah, it's David. But you always wish that there's more people, just like at least like someone to talk to. But that's like where friends come in. I mean,
and
I
mom.
Have, yeah, I have the best friends in the world and the best mom.
Yeah, listening, a lot of listening.
A lot of listening.
I do.
I think we both learn a lot from each other.
Yeah,
Definitely. We do.
We really do.
What I'd like to say to other teenagers that are in my same position is, you know, there is hope. Don't feel so down about what everybody says. Don't listen to what other people have to say about you when, if you know that you're a good person and that you're gonna do, like, you're the best that you can do and be the best that you can be, you're gonna go far in life, and that's really all that matters.
I want to talk for a second about the connections
between humans and the connections between all of us on this planet, and the way that what one person feels makes the next person feel and makes a community feel and makes the world feel. I have so much excitement and hope for the future because the people I've met are seriously some of the most amazing people, and they are going to take the world by storm because they have been through so much in their lives, so much that they did not need to go through, so much that many of them haven't been able to handle it, like Jim Wheeler. And they have come through that, and they are so strong, and just now, this revolution, this time that we're living in, just now, like no other time, they are finding each other. And when they realize the fact that they are blessed, the fact that they are beautiful, the fact that God is here, and if you believe in him, he is totally behind them. And that's the power. That's the part where they're gonna just look at each other and go, holy cow. And it's gonna be awesome. And it's going to become something incredible. And I have no idea what that's gonna be. But I know that people like the Wheelers are gonna see it, and we're all gonna see it. And hopefully, before too long, people who believe that homosexuality and gayness is wrong are gonna get it. I think that's the way love works. You just get it eventually.
We are 120 kilometers from home. That's an hour and a half from home. We're in Nova Scotia. And we're out of gas.